Everything old is new again. America's entertainment pop culture talk show.
It may well possess a rudimentary intelligence.
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Felt a great disturbance in the force.
Hello, I'm Mr. Ray.
Come on, Mark, like a dog for me.
Where's the goodies?
Leave the gun. Take the cannoli.
I bet you wouldn't have done anything like this if Mom and Dad were here.
You filthy criminal.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Here are your hosts, Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
Blondie! A pretty face, funny hat. That's what my blondie is.
Lovable feet, both flat. That's what my dagwood is.
We're back here on Everything Old is New Again on your radio when you thought it was safe to go to the refrigerator and get yourself a sandwich and listen to the show or listen to some music or whatever you were intending to listen to. We're back. Douglas Viviani with the ever hungry David Cohen on Everything Old is New Again.
Yes. This is one of my favorite topics today.
How do you like that? We stumbled upon Blondie. You love Blondie that much, I guess, huh? The movie from the 40s and 50s, those movie series?
Is this show about, like, old-time movies?
It could be about family comedies with that intro. It could be about radio shows turned into movies? No.
Or...
why did we pick Blondie? What's a Dagwood Bumstead? Do you ever hear of that?
It's a sandwich.
It's a sandwich. A sandwich with lots of layers. It just goes on and on, right? And that's from those movies. Now, the question is, since 100 B.C.
So just to be clear, the show is about sandwiches.
Yes.
Okay, just in case our listeners were as confused as I was, we're doing a show on sandwiches. Go with the history lesson.
Yes. No. This allows us to play whatever clips we want because this is an educational program, you see.
Ah.
So now, 100 BC, that's when the sandwich began. Through the height of the Roman Empire, they had them then. Through the Dark Ages, which we'll talk about where the name the sandwich came from. To the group of workers pictured on the skyscraper having lunch on the building. Have you seen this? When they're building the Empire State Building, they've got those workers on that beam all eating sandwiches.
Right.
Ever since the sandwich was invented, humankind has been trying to perfect this delicacy. Well, I'll tell you what. This week on Everything Old is New Again, we're going to take a look at the past, the present, the future of the sandwich. And at the end of the show, we're going to hold this to the end. We're going to present to you David Cohen and Douglas Viviani's new recipes for nouveau sandwiches. Of course, we're going to talk about sandwiches before then, all throughout. But at the end, stay tuned for some like brand new types of sandwiches you may never have had or tried. Now, David Cohen, you live in New York City, of course.
Yes.
The question is, and everyone I think or across the country may know, maybe not, what is a sandwich from the Carnegie Deli? What makes this place so popular, famous, that, by the way, went out of business and came back, didn't they?
And went out of business again, sadly.
Oh, yes, they're out right now again? Completely?
It's gone forever.
Oh.
Yeah.
What a poor example.
But what made Carnegie Deli and other delis in New York City that are similar to Carnegie so famous is, two things. One is the size of the sandwich you were talking about, the Dagwood Bumstead. I mean, they bring you out a sandwich, and it was literally, I would say, 10 to 12 inches high, packed with, not with bread. I mean, a lot of sandwiches today, you get like these thick rolls and there's maybe one slice of turkey on the whole thing.
Right.
But this is like 99% roast beef or
pastrami.
Pastrami or just all great, great aged meats. Ah, I miss it already.
So it's gone. And that's the thing we need to talk about is the sandwich has been around since 100 BC. And in America...
How do you know it wasn't earlier?
Because a Jewish rabbi told me this. His first...
I didn't expect that answer.
Hillel the Elder was a prominent Jewish rabbi who lived around the first century B.C., and what he did was the first one to put, believe this, now listen to this for a sandwich, chopped nuts, spices, apples, wine somehow, between two pieces of matzos. David Cohen, tell us fools that don't know what that is, what that is.
Matzah bread is basically, it's like unleavened bread. It's like a giant cracker, but it's very tasty.
And they called it the Hillel sandwich. And is it something, have you heard of this? Allegedly, it's something that's ingrained into the Passover celebration.
Yes, it is. It's the two pieces of matzah bread form the upper and lower bread encasing, if you will.
Well, do you have this at Passover? And if you do, is there wine on it?
I wouldn't say there's wine like on it. It's kind of hard to put wine on a sandwich, but usually the thing that you put on it are things for Passover that were prevalent at the time of that day and age.
Okay.
So there's like, you know, bitters and sweet stuff that you kind of mush up and you put it into the sandwich. It's quite good.
All right, so
I did not know it dated back to then.
So, you know, I'm a man of all faiths and talents, and so I reach back. I can even reach back a little further into the Middle Ages and tell you from the 6th through the 16th centuries, it's hard to say, people ate from plates, not blocks of, not any kind of blocks of wood, but what they started to do is they used bread, and meats and sauce were piled on top of each other and eaten with your fingers if you were someone that was of the poorer, quality, if you will. You didn't have, not quality, your income. You didn't have plates. You used bread, and that was dinner. It was basically a sandwich back in the day. You'd soak up the stew or whatever was being eaten. So that was that. Now, there comes a time when there's a gentleman by the name of Earl of Sandwich. His name was.
So they weren't called sandwiches back then.
No,
right?
they were Hillels or something of that nature, right? John.
And now Earl comes along.
And he's a gambler, and he does not want to be taken away from his gambling activities and whatever else he's doing. He's mostly gambling. So he says, "I got to invent some way to have dinner and have a meal without being pulled away from the gambling table." So he invented the sandwich. He put two pita breads together. He used all kinds of meat, any kind of meat he had around, and that became the sandwich. And the way it was known was, "I'll have the same as sandwich," is what everybody would say. "What are you going to have? I'll have the same as sandwich." Sandwich. And before you know it, they would just say, "Sandwich, I'll have a sandwich." And that's how the name sandwich came about. But beginning, the players that played against him would say, I'll have what sandwich is having. And before you know it, it became, "I'll have a sandwich."
Oh, so he was known as Earl of Sandwich? Like, people would refer to him as, "Hey, Sandwich, what's up?"
Well, like Earl of Sandwich was like, I presume, I have to look, they should have looked this up, I presume Sandwich is a place, a location.
It's a place, yeah.
Right.
And that's where he was from.
He was the Earl, the governor, if you will, of Sandwich.
But when you say, "I'll have what Sandwich is having," it sounds like they refer to Earl as Sandwich.
Correct.
Is that what you're gleaning from your Wikipedia entry?
It's not Wikipedia, and because it's called The Brief History of the Sandwich. I looked this up, and it's actually from The Sandwich, A Global History by B. Wilson. Just want you to know.
Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys?
That may have been a precursor, or she's a precursor. Now, there's another little thing here that I want to add to the pie.
We can agree. There's a murky past to the history of the sandwich.
Not to mention the Saturday Night Live skit.
A lot of different origins, stories, and recreations, and that sort of thing.
Correct.
Okay.
Remember Bill Murray playing the Earl of Sandwich?
No.
Look it up on YouTube. It's a good one.
All
now,
right.
Besides that, in the 1920s, you need to hear this, Otto Rowetter from Davenport, Iowa, and we're broadcasting lots in Iowa, so let's think about that. His descendants may be. In the 1920s, he invented the bread slicing machine. The invention made life easy for housewives all over the world and eventually spawned the phrase, what? The greatest thing.
It's the greatest thing.
Since sliced bread. Because sliced bread, they didn't have to take the loaf of bread and cut it and make sure it's evenly distributed and so forth, they're evenly cut. So from that point on, the sandwich took off from the 1920s till the present day. Now, we have a few minutes here, not a lot. So I want to go through a little more history then, and then when we come back, we'll talk a little bit about the breakfast sandwich in the present day. Did you know Americans eat how many, well, you tell me, how many sandwiches out of a 365-day-a-year calendar, how many sandwiches do you eat? And or then what would you think is the average person's consumption of sandwiches?
I would say about half of that.
So you're saying about
180 a year.
Okay, you're close. Yeah, they said 200 a year. 200 a year people eat sandwiches. Now, they were literally in cookbooks in the 1800s, early 1800s. And then they were used, in the Civil War, in taverns all over the place. And eventually, the turn of the century, the 19th century, came about triple-layered club sandwiches and the Reuben. So it's just, I think it's interesting that finally, in the 1920s, with the with the cutting of the bread, kids started to eat them, and they became a delicacy and all that. But for 100 years before, it was really a specialty, and it was in cookbooks, how to make a sandwich. Because they wouldn't just use cold cuts. They didn't have cold cuts. They would chop up leftovers, mix it with butter or mayo, and that would be basically the meat or the content of the sandwich.
I see.
We'll be back right at this. On Everything Old is New Again, we're going to get into some sandwiches. You may want to contact us if you like sandwiches, too, and suggest your own at everythingoldisnewagain.biz. We'll be back right after this.
Sloppy Joe's on me.
This is Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
These are s'more stuff. Okay, pay attention. First, you take the graham. You stick the chocolate on the graham. Then, you roast the mallow. When the mallow's flaming, you stick it on the chocolate. Then, you cover it with the other end.
Welcome back to Everything Old is New Again. Yes, make me one of those s'mores. S'mores. What, how do you pronounce that, David Cohen?
I believe it's s'more.
Okay.
Like a s'more, not a some more.
Now,
Or else they would have broken out the two separate words. It's s'mores. Like, can I have s'more?
All right, so is a s'more a sandwich? Yeah. And by the way, that clip was from the movie Sandlot, if you haven't seen that. I know you still have not seen that movie.
I know, it's crazy. I know, it's
3 years
list.
After we talked about that movie. But okay, now, question is this. Do you ever have a s'more in your life, ever, in New York City?
S'more. Do you ever have a s'more? Yes, I love s'mores.
How do you have them? Who makes them? Where do you make them?
Well, it's sad to say that my brother, who lives in Northern Virginia, he loves making s'mores. So when we go down to see them, he actually makes them at home. Otherwise, believe it or not, there are restaurants that have them on like dessert menus now. Whenever I see them, I order them.
And wow, now here's in New York City. I'm very curious. How much does it cost for a s'more dessert in New York City?
$135.
I was going to say. Marshmallows, graham cracker, and a piece of chocolate melted. Probably in New York City, I'm going to guess $14.95. Am I about right?
No, I would say in the $8 to $10 range.
All right, well, that's a bargain.
For a decently sized s'more.
But you get one or you get many?
Oh, just one.
Oh, God, help us. All right, that's why.
But it is, to answer your question, I think it is a legitimate sandwich.
All right, well, that's what we're doing. We're talking sandwiches here and Everything Old is New Again.
Now, we haven't addressed the official definition of a sandwich, and I don't think you wanted to go there because that can get very involved, and maybe that'll be another show.
Well, no, because the Oxford Dictionary has one.
I should have known. No. All right, here we go.
An item of food consisting of two pieces of bread with a filling between them, eaten as a light meal. Now, I have to disagree with the light meal part of it.
Yeah, me too. Well, then, wouldn't a hamburger be a sandwich?
I guess it would be. Well, this show is more or less on the sandwich that you can make at home. Of course, the generation of it comes from other places, but I'm talking about sandwiches you make and can make at home.
You can't make a hamburger at home?
Hamburgers are out. How about we just say that?
All right, that's
we
easy.
Did a whole show on hamburgers.
What about,
we tasted hamburgers.
What about
we did a show
dog?
A year before that on all the comeback of the hamburger. A year before that, we did all kinds of shows about Wimpy's and the commercials. We did a lot of hamburger stuff.
What about hot dogs? That's a sandwich?
We did a whole show on hot dogs. We did a hot dog-a-rama just recently. We've talked about hot dogs.
Okay, but we agree that those are sandwiches, but we're not talking about them on this show.
We're going to talk about the breakfast sandwich right now.
Ooh.
Change the subject. I go to a deli every so often in the morning if I have time, maybe once a week. And delis, I don't know if the definition of a deli. I mean, I don't know if everyone has delis around the country.
Sandwich shops, like just independently owned.
But they have more. You go into a deli, they've got all the cold cuts. They've got all kind of sides, all your salads. They have, right. But they also have all kinds of drinks. They also have chips. Everything you could possibly want to make your own little sandwich, if you will. You're right, it's a sandwich. But it has lots of other stuff too, drinks and whatever.
Sure.
So, but there seem to be on the way out. I see there used to be every every other block in Long Island growing up. Now, 30, 40 years later, it's hard to find a deli. Do you have any idea why? What's up with that? It's Subway and fast food putting out the deli?
I would think that contributes to it. I live in New York City, so that is still a thing. There are places, there are delis, you could, independently owned delis, you could just walk in.
I mean, because they're the best, because they take sandwich. They pay attention, and you can make your own sandwich, and they don't fill it, like, with all due respect, Subway, you got like three pieces of meat. That's not a sandwich. You know what I mean? That's not a sandwich. And their bread is odd. Anyways, we'll get to that.
It's, to me, Subway makes flavored bread.
Yes.
That's basically what they're
giving
you.
It's true. All right, so now, the breakfast sandwich that I get, two eggs over medium, bacon, cheese, salt, on a toasted buttered roll. Really healthy.
Salt.
Well, you got to remind them to put salt on these days. They won't put salt on, let's just say it.
On a buttered roll.
On a toasted buttered roll.
Oh, wow. That's
but that
so
will carry me, yes, that will carry me to dinner, actually, believe it or not. It is so filling. I don't think there are those sandwiches all over the country. It's when done well. Of course, the roll has to be nice and fresh. Maybe sesame. The tomato. The bacon's got to be nice and crispy. And the it's all made fresh for you right then and there. And I don't know. I mean, I enjoy that.
Yeah.
What is your favorite breakfast sandwich?
Well, do you ever get it on a bagel, or is it just on like a Kaiser roll?
No,
like
the bagel is too hard because you bite into it and the bagel interferes and squishes the interior of the sandwich and it squeezes out the side and it gets messy.
Not a good bagel. If you get a good bagel, it doesn't squish anything out.
Why? Is that what you're doing for breakfast?
No, well, I do. Yeah, one of my favorite. Well, I was going to talk about the Egg McMuffin, but in a similar vein, I've had Egg McMuffins on sesame bagels, which are quite delicious.
Now, you're saying Egg McMuffins, and you're doing, are you cooking this
I'm
yourself?
Doing it. Yeah, so we were talking about Egg McMuffins that McDonald's sells, obviously, and I like those too, although they've shrunk in
size. They're horrible now. They're horrible.
Considerably.
Yes.
They're like the size of a hockey puck.
Let me stop you for a moment. Just as a little PSA. I used to work at McDonald's back in the 70s. We actually made the eggs. Okay, well, to order for those sandwiches, nice and fresh.
Really?
And made the sandwich fresh. Now, everything's going into a microwave oven. Show me them cracking an egg behind the counter, and I'll buy it.
No way.
That's why they're disgusting now. It's you might as well get one from the frozen food aisle and heat it up in your microwave. It's the same thing as the Egg McMuffin now. The original, I agree with you, was terrific. So making it yourself is the way to go. I agree with that. Do you use bacon or do you use the ham?
Oh, I use the Canadian ham like McDonald's does because it's nice and round and it fits on the English in the same shape as the English muffin. So I put a slice of American cheese, actually whatever cheese I happen to have sliced at that point, maybe provolone or American or cheddar. And then I make two eggs. I don't do it very well, but I try to form them into the shape of the English muffin as well.
Yep.
So I essentially recreate, and no butter, though. No butter.
And how about the eggs? How are you making the eggs? Are you doing them over heavy?
Over heavy. I don't know over easy. I don't like the runny.
How about, I'm going to give you a little change of pace. How about doing it with a scrambled egg?
Yeah, that's, I've tried that. The problem with scrambled egg is that when you bite into the Egg McMuffin, it can kind of fall out, to your point before about what a bagel can do. So that's why I usually make like a little egg omelet. I whip it up and try to shape it into the shape of the bread.
Now, they have these things that you can do, a little hint. They're little, you ever see cookie cutters? It's sort of a cookie cutter. It's a round, it's not a cookie cutter, it's a round metal piece that you can put on your grill.
I've been meaning to buy that for years, and I just never did it. So I just like fold, I make like an omelet, I keep folding the egg over.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
So that it's a smaller size.
All right. I like it a little juicier, so I don't mind if it actually spills all over into the plate and all that, because then you could soap it up with your bread, whatever you got.
Ew, no, I don't like sopping up the yolk with the bread.
even if it's scrambled eggs and they come out, use a knife and fork and put it back in. It's okay.
Yeah, that could be. It's just not as convenient. Not as compact.
Well, talk about messy sandwiches. Now let's get to lunch. I want to go provincial here. In southeastern Massachusetts and Rhode Island, they have a sandwich that I don't even know how you could possibly call this a sandwich in that it's just going to mess out everywhere. It's called a chow mein sandwich.
Really?
It's got noodles on bread with a chow mein with the brown rice, stir-fried pork or chicken, vegetables placed on a hamburger bun, and they say it's strangely delicious. I've never tried it. I went to school in Rhode Island. I don't know why I never tried it. I never even knew it existed, but there it is.
Wow, like that's interesting. It sounds like it would be messy, but good.
Right. Do you have one that you like, a sandwich that's from another part of the country that you could bring to light?
Oh, one of my favorite sandwiches is a Cuban.
Okay.
You ever have a Cuban?
Explain
you ever
to
have
us.
A Cuban sandwich?
I have. Explain.
All right. So the Cuban sandwich is obviously originated in, Doug, where did the Cuban sandwich originate?
Well, that would be from Cuba, but we only have a minute and a half, so.
But actually, it's more popular in
Florida.
Florida, especially down in Key West, where they make some of the best Cuban sandwiches. But I've had, you know, pretty good facsimiles all the way up north.
And what
here.
Is a Cuban sandwich? Let's get to it.
All
Cuban.
Right. So, Cuban, here we go. There are specific things that need to be in a Cuban sandwich to call it an actual Cuban sandwich.
Get to the point.
First, you need a Cuban-style bread. You need mustard. You need both, and this is, you have to be clear on this point, both roast pork and ham. Yes, same animal, but you need both. You need Swiss cheese, and you need thinly sliced pickles.
That's the key. Okay?
That is, you need those basic ingredients. And for me, I don't like to add anything or subtract anything. To me, that's the
but
classic.
But be clear about it. You then put it on the grill and cook it as if it was a...
Like a panini, you know, like you press it down and
yes,
you grill it.
Yes, yeah. So but if you're making it at home, you just put a little butter on the grill and you put the bread on that, fry it up on the one side, turn it over, fry it up on the other side, as if you're doing a grilled cheese sandwich.
Exactly.
I mean, if you're doing it at home, or you could press it. If you got a George Foreman, you could do it that way too.
Or even if you press it down with like a spatula,
right?
Then you're good.
It's a nice combo. It really is a nice combo.
Ah, I love it. It's so good and so bad for you.
Well, none of these sandwiches are good for you. That's for sure. One that I used to love at school that originated in New Jersey was a long time ago. Was the you ready for this? I don't know if you're ready.
I'm ready.
The Sloppy Joe.
I know. Yeah.
The Sloppy Joe, if everybody, you can still get those to these days. Every so often, I force the kids on a Saturday to join me in a Sloppy Joe that you can make. You take it out of the can, you heat it up on a frying pan, you put it on toast or, some bread that has some substance to it so it doesn't, fall apart, and you've got a Sloppy Joe. It's beef and a little tomato sauce, basically.
So, but to explain to our listeners, it's like, it's very finely chopped beef, right?
Yes. It's like a hamburger that's never congealed. It never became a hamburger.
Exactly.
It's too much
so
stuff to make it a hamburger.
And it's sloppy because when you, before you even bite into it, as you're picking it up off the plate, the meat is dropping off the sandwich.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And when you bite into it even more, but that's the great thing about it because you just, you take a fork and you put it back onto the bread and you try it again.
Correct. We'll be back. Right at this and everything all is new again. Continue. What is Captain Kirk's favorite sandwich? We'll find out when we return.
The Spock.
This is Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
These are s'more stuff. Okay, pay attention. First, you take the graham. You stick the chocolate on the graham. Then, you roast the mallow.
When the mallow's flaming,
you stick it on the chocolate.
Set the place on fire, Ham.
You cover it with the other end.
Yeah, make me one of those.
Welcome back to Everything Old is New Again. Yeah, make me one of those. I like that. That's from The Sandlot, the movie The Sandlot. Yes, we did hear that last section introduction again because we're having so much fun. We're going to continue with the sandwich show here on Everything Old is New Again. And we may even do this next week. We'll see. Write to us if you think we should continue with the sandwich evaluation by Everything Old is New Again. And you write to us at oldnewagain@aol.com. That's oldnewagain@aol.com. And if you want to go online and hear our old shows, you go to everythingoldisnewagain.biz. That's .biz. And, of course, we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, and we're on LinkedIn. So take a look at all those locations. Soon, we are going to have all of our shows self-contained on our website. Right now, it sends you to YouTube. But someone recently stole, David doesn't even know this, all of our YouTube channel. They made it their own brand, and stole all shows. So I eliminated all those shows. I stole it back, but it's a long story short is I had to make a brand new YouTube channel, and I'm downloading all 275 shows one at a time, and it's taken a long time to do it. I'm at about 80 right now. So anyway.
So there isn't any other fake site or access point out there with our shows, is there?
I don't know what this guy did. What happened was it was stolen from somebody in India, and then it was sold to someone in Vietnam, and then the Vietnam person made our shows their brand and started getting hits on our show. I don't understand that. They must have been using it for another reason. I can't figure it out. So it took a long time, but I got it back. But in so doing, they did something with all of our shows on YouTube, and if you click on one that they stole that I didn't fix back yet again, the shows cannot be viewed. So I don't. I wonder. This is really stretching it. If there's any competitors of ours that went ahead and said, "Get all those YouTube," because we're getting a lot of hits. Get all those YouTube shows off the YouTube. I don't know. What do I know? But
maybe they just translated it into Chinese or whatever language they speak.
Well, doesn't everyone kind of speak English too, sooner or later, right? My point is that I've found a way to put them on our website so they'll be self-contained as well. But first, I'm going to reestablish the YouTube because that's so popular. So. Anyway, that's where we're at. Spent 3 minutes on our
presence. Well, it's a little flattering to have someone steal your material, I guess, right?
Yes and no, because I don't know why they did it. You know what I mean? Like, maybe they did it because they hate the show and don't want to. I don't know. I'm tired of that presence. What can I tell you? I don't know. But if you go online and like the YouTube, you'll see it's Everything Old is New Again radio show is the YouTube channel. Pull that up, and you'll see, of course, all of them there. And I'm going from the most recent ones backwards. So I'm back into 2018 right now. Anyway, we're continuing our discussion, if you're still here listening to us, about the sandwich. Now, when I grew up, we used to go to the park, play baseball, like all morning. And then we all had our bicycles. We took a break. We were in an area where it was self-contained neighborhood with a park. But on the outskirts, you could ride. And not go over like a double yellow line, because that was our exclusion. We weren't allowed to ride our bicycles over a road with a double yellow line because we were like 10, 11. But we could
Isn't there oncoming traffic that coming the other way?
Yeah, that would probably be why our parents didn't want us to do that. I'm not saying it was a bad prohibition.
Things really had to be explained to you back then in the simplest terms.
But there was a few delis close in bicycle riding distance. So every day in the summer, and sometimes in September, October, and in May and April, we'd be playing football, whatever. We would definitely ride our bikes to the deli, whether it would be to get a sandwich, whether it would be to get chips or a combination or drinks. It was the most fun, candy. It was the most fun place for a kid that you can go. It was a reasonably priced. You got a plethora of all kinds of candy and snacks and cupcakes and whatever you wanted. But we did focus a lot of the time, of course, on the sandwich. And I thought it was very interesting. Everyone that I knew went to get a sandwich at the deli, got a different sandwich. Never had the same sandwich. Like, it was
really?
Like, I'll have what this guy's having. I'll have the roast beef. Everyone made their own sandwiches up. You never had that experience? Because you grew up in the city, but different
Actually, now that I'm thinking about it, that's true. Like, there always seems to be a different sandwich for every individual person. That's very interesting.
No one has the same sandwich. It's impossible.
True. Right.
And do you ever go to these places now? And, like, the bagel stores sometimes do this now. They try to be delis out of Long Island anyway. And they have a plethora of sandwiches suggested on the wall. The Monte Cristo, the Bupa de Bupa, and they name after all the different people in it. I am not spending time to read the ingredients of all these individual sandwiches that they named after the guy down the block that's come in 17 times in a row and ordered the same sandwich, so let's name it after him, you know? So I'm not doing that. So do you? I mean, have you memorized any of these sandwiches by name and what's in them and all this?
See, I think I'm the exact opposite. If I read all the sandwiches, the pre-made sandwiches,
right.
Not pre-made, but I mean like the recipes for the sandwiches on the board. And if I see one I like, I'll usually pick that instead of trying to create my own.
Yeah, for some reason,
I
find that as an affront to me. I don't know why. It must be because when I was a kid, we all made our own, you know? I find it, in some way, it's so stupid, but I find it like a slap in my face. And listen, I know what you have, and I know what I can make. I'll tell you what my sandwich is. They'll tell me what you're going to make.
But did you get really creative? Did you order the same thing? Like, the turkey provolone?
Oh, no. I will tell you sandwiches as we progress on this show that I used to order and even still do order on occasion that will blow your mind. Okay. But before we do that, I want to stick with a little more about around the country and different kinds of sandwiches that, I don't know, people may not be aware of in different parts of the country. So how about, like, if you visited St. Louis, Missouri, you may have, and we're broadcasting in that general area, a sandwich that they call the St. Paul, which is one of the last bastions, they say, of the, they call it a fried brain sandwich. I'll let that sink in. But it's not really a brain. It's really a Chinese-American sandwich, they're calling it. Because they use egg foo young, which looks like a brain, right? And they use lettuce, tomato, onion, pickles, and mayo between two slices of white sandwich bread. Now, I don't know. Where does that even sound interesting to you?
It doesn't. That's very strange. But, whatever. Maybe if I was a St. Louisian, I'd be in. I probably would be in.
I mean, you're insulting all of those Midwesterners in Missouri and in surrounding areas that may love this. I don't know. Because it's been around since 1940. It's reminiscent, I guess, of the chow mein in that it's putting Chinese food. But this is different. They're putting that egg foo young patty, which is basically eggs and onion and bean sprouts, right? And they're mixing that on top of it with lettuce, tomato, onion, pickles, and mayo, which is really different. It's not that sauce that you're putting on. You get me? The egg foo young, you usually have a brown sauce you put on it. You familiar with this?
Upon closer inspection, I didn't mean to put down anyone living in St. Louis. It actually sounds interesting.
It does.
My only point was, you know, sometimes you hear what goes into a sandwich and your first reaction is, oh, that's different.
Right.
But if you're living in that area and you grew up with it, you probably love it. Or else why would it be, you know, on these little pieces of paper we have in our hands right now?
And somehow the bread makes it interesting, too. Of course, depends on what kind of bread. But let's say you did one of those chow mein sandwiches from Massachusetts and you use like sourdough or some kind of heavy bread that won't disappear, that will hold up to this stuff and still have a nice flavor. I bet you that chow mein sandwich is pretty interesting.
Yeah, I mean, bread to me is a huge part of what makes a quality sandwich. It has to stay together and hold the ingredients in and not overpower it, but also add some flavor to it.
Now, we've been talking about Maine. David Cohen, I know you have one of your sandwiches you love that's made for or originated in Maine. David Cohen.
And also very big in all of the New England states is the lobster roll. A lobster roll. We were talking before about whether we consider a hot dog a sandwich, and I believe we said yes, but won't discuss those for this show.
Correct.
But a lobster roll essentially uses the hot dog bun, but instead of putting a hot dog in it, they take chopped up lobster meat, blend it with some mayonnaise, and I'm sure put some butter on the hot dog roll as well. And it is really, really delicious because if you're doing it right, you're using fresh lobster, and there's nothing like fresh lobster in New England.
Right.
And it's not like tuna salad where sometimes there's like more mayonnaise than fish. This is primarily lobster with, if it's made right, with just a hint of mayonnaise in the background. So if it's made right, it is one of my favorite sandwiches.
Have you done this?
It's served cold.
Out in Montauk, there's a couple of places that make it the world famous.
Yeah, sure. World famous, whatever that means, yes. No, but I've had them in Massachusetts and in Maine, and there's nothing like them.
I agree. It's tremendous. You will love it. We'll be back right after this. Everything goes new again. Continue talking all things sandwiches.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took.
Now, back to America's Entertainment Pop Culture Talk Show. Everything old is new again with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
my sandwich is all wet.
Yeah, they're all wet, but... Oh, God. The dog went on the picnic basket.
We are back here on Everything Old is New Again. That's a little piece of looking into the movie Vacation when they were traveling and they were just around the Grand Canyon and they were trying to eat their lunch, a couple sandwiches that were made, and of course there was a problem. So long story short, we're going to continue with that discussion of the sandwich. Now, I teased a little earlier, David Cohen, about sandwiches... that, or a sandwich that Captain Kirk from Star Trek, or Omnipresent Star Trek reference, is his favorite sandwich. Now, that's a great trivia question. I will say this. Well, I guess we can't do a contest. I'm going to play it and answer the question now. But if you want to amplify on that, there is another reference to sandwiches in the new Star Trek movies, those J.J. Abrams movies. I will say that. And it is in the first of those movies. And it's made by Scotty. So if you know the answer of what that reference to sandwiches were, write to us at oldnewagain@AOL.com, oldnewagain@AOL.com, and you will win a sandwich of your liking that we will
is
pay
the
for.
Is the sandwich of Scottish origin? Is that why Scotty makes it?
Nope, but he does make a reference when he meets Spock. I'll leave it at that. That's very much very... clear, concise clue. You can look that up and find it. In the meantime, what is Captain Kirk's favorite sandwich? Here we go.
My chicken sandwich and coffee. This is my chicken sandwich and coffee.
From The Trouble with Tribbles, a chicken sandwich and coffee, as he says. I don't know.
And what?
And he's really coffee, but he's using that different. Like in New York, we say coffee. I'll take a cup of coffee. Hey, you got coffee, milk for coffee, you got a little sugar for the coffee, everybody with the coffee in the morning. It's everywhere, this coffee. We'll do a show on that for sure.
And how does he say it?
Cup of coffee.
Cup of coffee?
I'll have a cup of coffee. Oh, that's what it is.
That's weird. Anyway. Weird. What kind of accent is that?
He's from Iowa.
Shatner Iowa accent. It's a Shatnerese.
Well, Shatner's from Canada, but the character, Captain Kirk, is from Iowa.
Yeah, it still doesn't
make
sense.
Farm boy from Iowa.
Say coffee?
How would a farm boy from Iowa say it? He wouldn't even drink.
I think just coffee. Coffee. How else would you say it? There's no real thick accent in Iowa.
Well, I guess in outer space, things are change the way you talk a little bit. Can I tell you?
We could do a whole show. No, okay, never mind.
We probably have. Oh, well.
All right, so it's a chicken sandwich?
Chicken sandwich is Captain Kirk's favorite. When I was growing up.
What does that mean? What is a chicken sandwich? Like chicken salad, or is it a
good question.
Chicken breast?
You could do chicken sandwiches three different ways, if you ask me. Chicken salad, and if you're doing a chicken salad, I do not want you cutting the chicken up in cubes. I want that chicken minced or pulled apart, like a pulled pork sandwich.
Right.
And mixed with mayonnaise. And a little hint, a smidge of mustard, that Bowers mustard will work nicely.
Yeah, that sounds good.
On a toasted...
But do you know Kirk's specific chicken sandwich?
I don't know, because the Tribbles came out instead. There was trouble there. We never saw it. But you could do a breaded, you could do a chicken cutlet with a little mayo and some...
Well, sure, yeah.
And a cheese on top and melt that a little bit. That's a nice one.
I feel a little let down. I do. I mean, you know, you're making this big reveal about his favorite sandwich that Scotty made for him, and the only word he uttered about it was a chicken sandwich and a coffee?
And a cup of coffee.
So you have no idea how this chicken sandwich was made.
The Tribbles ate it. What are you going to do? We couldn't. That was it. But there is another reference in the new Star Trek.
Are you going to tell us that?
Maybe next week I'll tell you that. I want to see if anybody can win the prize. Email us.
All right, okay, fair enough.
Now, here's one when I was a kid. It was so simple. I don't know why only my grandparents would make this for me. I don't know why. Maybe it was too easy. A BLT. It's the most simple sandwich. I don't think it's around anymore. Toast.
Bacon, lettuce, and tomato? Sure.
On toast with a little mayo. Yeah, it's a tremendous sandwich. You don't go for that one?
Not really. To me, it's not enough. It just seems like a cop-out. Like, here's this sandwich, all right? So first of all, you know, there's going to be lettuce and tomato on it, right? Because that's on every sandwich. But wait for it. Here we go. We're putting bacon in it. Yeah. And what else? That's it. Just the lettuce, the tomato, and a couple of strips of bacon. And
guess what?
And that's a BLT.
To a kid of 10, that's a big hit. I'm telling you. Matter of fact, I'm going to make that for my kids this weekend and see what they think. Because they've never had it.
Good luck.
You know why? Because bread is on the way out. Everybody with the bread, it's enough with the, you know, too much bread, too much carbs. So, like, you don't really want to eat that because it's mostly bread.
Why do you need the rest? If you like bacon so much, just eat the bacon.
Right.
Why do you need the lettuce and the tomato and the bread around it? That's my point. Yeah. Bacon in a sandwich usually goes on top of something else within the sandwich. No?
Now, we are in broadcasting in a couple of places in California. Now, in California, they do the BLT, but Eureka, which is their motto. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Eureka. They came up with the idea of adding avocado.
So it's now that's something.
All right. So it's a BLTA. That's the new moniker of the sandwich.
That's got a little more beef, if you will, to it. I like that.
Well, yeah, they put the avocado and they make believe it's a healthy sandwich. It's still a BLT. It's still got the bread. It's still got the mayo.
Right.
But all right, now I'm eating healthy. I got avocado. So that's that's a pretty cool one. I know that young David Cohen is a big fan. This has come up in the past. Of a sandwich that you can make at home. As a matter of fact, they have Steak-ums. So you can make your own Philly cheesesteak at home, although, of course, it wouldn't be the same. But Steak-ums, as a kid, I used to do. Do you remember those little really thin pieces of... Yeah. Did you used to make...
I thought that was good. Yeah, my mom used to make them. I thought it was really good until I went to Philadelphia.
All right. Now we're going to make everybody jealous that's living everywhere else because Philadelphia is the place for the, of course... Philadelphia
cheesesteak.
Tell us a little about the history. Why are you so hopped up about this sandwich?
Well, I went to Philadelphia to see. I'm a big hockey fan, so I think I did a road trip with a friend of mine when I was pretty young up to Philly,
down.
We kept hearing about Pat's and Geno's, these two Philly cheesesteak places that were in competition with each other. And we just stopped by to give it a try, and I just became a different person from that point.
Explain what it is first.
Okay, so the Philly cheesesteak, it's pretty basic, but for some reason, I've never had one outside of Philadelphia that tasted anything like the cheesesteaks they make in Philly. And there's not, you can't say that about a lot of these, like, locally, you know, identified sandwiches. Okay, so what goes into the Philly cheesesteak, for people who have not heard about it, and if you haven't, look, you're strange. That's all I can say.
Well, it's not available to everybody. That's the problem.
It's not. That's the sad part. So you may have had facsimiles of a Philly cheesesteak, but trust me, only in Philadelphia can you get a real one.
So steak, cheese, onions on a roll with is that basically it?
Well, it's part of it, but it's a very delicate balance, you see, of the ingredients.
So let's hear it.
Okay, first you need the right kind of bread, all right? You need a long, crusty roll, right, that's going to be able to absorb all the juice and everything that goes on
it. You got to stop you for a second. Do they toast it? They don't toast it, and which
No, they do
prefer?
Not toast it. It's fresh, absolutely fresh
bread. So it holds up without being, because to me, just as an aside, I would toast some kinds of bread that wouldn't hold up on its own to at least give it some substance. So now you're saying it doesn't even need that.
Bread.
All right, go ahead.
It's basically what the steak is. It's very thinly sliced, sautéed ribeye beef. Okay, and that could be chopped. It could be long slices. Every Philly cheesesteak place makes it differently. I like it sort of like more chopped. And then the key though is the melted cheese. Now it might sound weird, but there's a big argument over what kind of cheese goes into a traditional Philly cheesesteak. Most people will tell you go with Cheese Whiz, believe it or not.
Mm.
But if not Cheese Whiz, then like a mild or sharp provolone is also very common on the cheesesteak. And it's mixed in with the chopped meat. It's not poured directly on it. It's all
kind of
like
melting with the hot meat. It's melting in between the different layers of the meat.
Exactly. And the meat is... You know, there's like a little bit of a drip factor with the meat, so it can't be too dry. It's got to be a little on the greasy side. It's got to run off the sandwich sometimes. Could be a little sloppy. But the bread has got to encompass everything, keep everything together, and you have to have the right mix of those ingredients. Now, you could also add, a lot of people add like chopped onions, like grilled onions, which is very good. Mushrooms is another ingredient people usually put on it. But I just like it just the way it was intended, just the meat and the cheese and the
now,
bread.
Now, there is a problem in Philly because there are two stores, or I'm not going to call them delis, but Philly cheese markets, let's say, that are across the street from each other. Was it Gino's and what's the name of it?
Yeah, that's what I was, if you were listening to what I was saying in the beginning.
No, go ahead.
Pat's and Gino's.
Yes, explain, you only have 30 seconds left. What's up with them? What are they arguing over?
Well, which has the best cheesesteak? But my argument is, and I prefer Pat's, but really, when it comes down to it, they're both outstanding. But there are other, listen, here's how much I like Philly cheesesteaks. I get in my car and I drive the 2 hours to Philadelphia to try a different cheesesteak, and then I get in the car and I drive home.
Who's going with you on this trip?
Usually it's my wife, believe it or not.
She will go.
She's into it as well.
Do you ever bring any home to have like a second round for dinner?
Yeah, they don't travel well. You got to kind of eat them right there. So Pat's is good. Just if you're ever in Philly, Pat's or Gino's, Jim's, D'Alessandro's.
15
those,
seconds.
I would say Steve's Prince of Steaks, those are the five top ones. Done.
All right, we'll be back next week to continue talking all things sandwiches and everything old is new again. You've been listening to Everything Old is New Again, America's pop culture entertainment talk show. Find us on the web at everythingoldisnewagain.biz. That's .biz.
See you next week. Same bat time, same bat station.